Bryan Harsin appears that he may be on his way out as the Auburn head coach. And when we had our show on Friday, we didn't talk about it because stuff started springing up Thursday night roundabout. And then on Friday, it all hit the fan. And you couldn't tell what was real, what wasn't. What we do know is that they have had over 20 players transfer out. A lot of them disgruntled, a lot of them upset. But then there are a lot that did have very good things to say about Bryan Harsin. Not the players that have left, but the players that are actually on the team, etc. And a lot of it sounds like guys that are not used to being coached hard that didn't appreciate the business-only side of things, right? That's a lot of this is very strange stuff. The rumors that went around online, we're not gonna talk about those on the show because we try and keep this a somewhat professional operation here. But
well, it's not that it's a professional operation. If they had any merit to them, then it would be worth talking about, and I'd absolutely talk about it.
But the problem is, if there was merit
after the weekend, we figured out. It just seems to be they were completely and utterly 100% fabricated.
So there was a statement from Auburn today, and I'll read the statement, on Monday. It said, the Auburn administration is judiciously collecting information from a variety of perspectives, including our student-athletes, and moving swiftly to understand any issues in accordance with university policies and procedures. Decisions regarding the future of Auburn and its athletics programs, as always, are made in the interest of our great university and in fairness to all concerned. We do not make institutional decisions based on social media posts or media headlines. So, here is what we know. There's been a lot of staff turnover. There has been a lot of player turnover in Harsin's first year. You get that a lot with first-year coaches that are coming in trying to establish a new culture. They are trying to change things around, but typically you don't get it at middle of the year, right? He fired his wide receivers coach in the middle of his first season. That's somebody that came with him. Like, that's an interesting thing. It's not somebody that was left over. That's somebody that he brought in. So that kind of is concerning right off the bat. Derek Mason, it was announced on Monday afternoon. Derek Mason actually took a $400,000 pay cut to go be the Oklahoma State defensive coordinator just so he could get out of Auburn. Like, if you're leaving to take at least the same pay somewhere else, that's one thing. But when you are taking nearly $500,000 pay cut to go somewhere, that's not just a lateral move. That is, I am just doing anything to get out of Dodge. The Austin Davis stuff last week, obviously, may not have been Harsin's fault, but certainly looks bad. What we're seeing here with all the rumors and everything is the same thing that Auburn has done forever, and that is you don't know who is running the football program. This looks a lot like the boosters and the people with money and the powers that be really wanted these rumors to stick, or they wanted to run Harsin out of town. They wanted him to quit, and he has basically said, because he's in Mexico right now, he's on vacation. He said, you know what? I am going to be the Auburn football coach until they tell me I'm not. And props to him for doing that, for standing up for that. But this is a strange, strange situation. What were your thoughts when you heard all of this stuff coming out over the weekend?
Yeah, so the rumor mill, you know, I didn't know if there was any to it or not. I didn't know if they were true or not. If they were true, they were damning. But you know my philosophy on all these things. Unless you break an unbreakable rule, if you think he's your guy, you stand by him. Not to fire somebody because they got some messiness in their life. Yeah. And you know, I just don't care about those things. If you're an Auburn fan who wants him gone, good excuse to get him gone.
Oh, yes.
But once again, I don't have an opinion one way or the other about those things because I'm very agnostic on Harsin. I don't think he's a bad coach. I don't think he's a great coach. And he hasn't had any time at all at Auburn to really get a development of what he is and what he's not. So, so that's for the rumor mill part and the messiness part. The coordinators leaving, there are plenty of people at Auburn that 100% believe that it didn't matter if Auburn went 12-0 and won the national title. Both coordinators were going to be gone after the end of the year. They didn't want to really be there, but the phone really, I guess, wasn't ringing a lot for either one of them, which is shocking for Derek Mason. But it seemed to be his two choices were Auburn with a new coach or LSU with a coach that was on his way out. And he said, it's better to be 1 year with here, and then I can leave on my own terms. They just didn't agree philosophy-wise on what to do. That's fine, too. That's okay. I don't think that's a negative on Harsin. Plenty of coaches are hard to work with. Plenty of very successful coaches are very difficult to work with.
Yes.
There are some that are great, that are easy to work with, and everybody loves them. There are some that are assholes that win all the time, and everyone hates working for them. I don't know that that tells you enough about what he is as a coach. Okay. The messiness that's going on at Auburn, I have no idea. The people that are in charge need to take charge. That's the most important thing. If you've got some boosters that are getting out of line and getting out of hand and starting rumors that are just making shit up to potentially ruin someone's life, those people have to go. They have to go. Somebody has to stand up to them and tell them, you're not welcome here anymore.
So it's interesting. Auburn, when you look at this situation, and everybody has known what goes on at Auburn for years and years and years, right, when it comes to the boosters. Bobby Lauder has forever been kind of the leader in the clubhouse, the one that kind of wrangles all the boosters up, right? There's Mr. Yellowwood himself. There's all kind of different guys that are involved, and you don't know who is actually running the program. Josh Pate talked about this on Late Kick on Sunday evening, but he said when you bring up Alabama, you know Nick Saban runs that program. When you bring up Georgia, you know that Kirby Smart runs that program. Now at LSU, Brian Kelly's only been there 2 months, and you know that he has put his stamp on it. He is the guy running the show. At Auburn, you never know who that answer is, right? Because even when Gus Malzahn was there, it wasn't Gus. So you don't know who it is that you're actually answering to. And that's Brent Venables. In his opening press conference as the Oklahoma head coach, he was telling the story, and his daughter asked him why he didn't take the Auburn job, and he said, I don't know that everything is properly aligned there. I didn't know who I was answering to. I mean, that tells you everything that you need to know in this situation. Bryan Harsin wanted to be out of Boise because of Mountain West stuff, because of maybe Boise stuff as well. I mean, who knows? But he wanted to take a shot at something bigger, and he comes down here, doesn't really know what he's getting involved with, and now we see this situation. I mean, it is a complete disaster. One of the interesting things, Andy Staples had an article in The Athletic on Sunday, and he thinks it's not just all of this other stuff, the stuff that happened during the season, because remember, this team was 6-2 before Bo Nix got hurt. And then, of course, Nix gets hurt. It's 6-3 because they lost to Texas A&M. But Andy Staples said, if you want to make it as simple as possible, the reason why those guys want Harsin out is number 141. That's the number. He said, we can boil it down to that number because that is the highest ranking on the 247 sports composite of any of Auburn signees in the class of 2022. Auburn ranked number 18 in the country, which sounds great until you really pay attention. That's 8th in the SEC. It is behind 4 of Auburn's annual opponents. That's A&M, Alabama, Georgia. That's number 1, 2, and 3. And then LSU, number 12. Toss in that Billy Napier is now coming in. Toss in all these other things that you've got to deal with in the SEC. If you don't get players, especially in your first recruiting class when you've really had an opportunity to build hype before trying to sell anything that you've done, this is a little crazy. Now, why would they do this right now? Now that we're in February, right after signing day? Who knows? I do know that there are still people down there that love Kevin Steele and still want him to be the head coach. Remember, there was a coup to get Malzahn fired, and a lot of the boosters were behind getting Kevin Steele the head job. He was the defensive coordinator at the time. The boosters did not want Bryan Harsin. The boosters wanted Kevin Steele or somebody else like that, but they didn't want Harsin. Harsin was the We'll call it the compromise. I think I'm going to use that word a couple of times today. But that was the compromise because the AD just took control of the hire. And usually we applaud situations like that until we realize that Allen Green, the AD, may still not have control of this program. It is really fascinating to watch what is happening here. Do you have more thoughts on just the recruiting, on what's going on so far, or anything that that Bryan Harsin has actually said thus far?
Well, no, but like if you know you've got changeover at your coordinator's position, then you're obviously going to take it on the chin a little bit and recruit, right? Like that's normal, okay? So I don't think that's anything that I would freak out about or panic about or whatever. The fact that you've got a top 18 class and top 20 class in the country is pretty good considering all the other things going on there. Okay? So like while it's easy to say look at all the negatives, yeah. Okay. They've got their biggest rivals are Alabama, Georgia, and LSU, and those teams look to be doing better than them. But at the end of the day, this stuff is all cyclical. There's going to come a time where they're going to be fine. They were literally one play away with a backup quarterback that could barely move the football and could barely move himself from beating Alabama. If Tank Bigsby don't run out of bounds, Alabama, there's a real good chance Alabama just loses that game.
Agreed.
And then history of Bryan Harsin is completely different. They lost, what, 5-6 one-score games? So if the ball bounces another way and they win half of those, and now they got 3 extra wins from last year, we're not having any of these conversations. None of this shit's happening.
Yeah,
so to assume that it's all doom and gloom and it's all going to fall apart, it's just ridiculous, okay? Bo Nix looked better under Harsin's than we've ever seen Bo Nix look. I have to assume that Calzada is going to be better than Bo Nix because Bo wasn't great, okay? I think Harsin wants to run a more stable offense instead of relying on a quarterback to just pull something out of his ass. I think he would rather run an offense that's maybe more reserved. Maybe he doesn't have the ability to be as electric as Bo, but he's also not going to bring all the problems with Bo. So the other side's not going to have as many extra possessions, those types of things. And so there's a world where this team is fine, okay? And all of this stuff is just, it's just noise and chaos and whatever. Auburn is fun to poke fun at, and so people take pop shots, all right? It's easy because their boosters are a little out of control, and they just go off, you know, on their own and do things that don't make sense to the most of us. But at the end of the day, Bryan Harsin's the coach. I think they have a slight upgrade at quarterback. The running back position is one of the best in the country coming back next year. You know, I just think they're going to be okay when it comes to actually playing football, and that's all that matters. That's all that matters.
Yeah, I will tell you the one position where they're going to have problems is defensive line, right? Because they lost a ton of their depth in the portal, and they didn't recruit any. So that certainly hurts. This Andy Staples article, he talked about Saban's first full class at LSU, like his first full cycle. He brought in Marcus Spears. This was predating 247 and all that. But they brought in Marcus Spears, Michael Clayton, Joseph Addai, Andrew Whitworth, Ben Wilkerson, like top players in 2008. Saban's first full cycle at Alabama. Brought in Julio Jones, Dante Hightower, Mark Barron, Courtney Upshaw, Mark Ingram, Barrett Jones, Marcel Darius, like all of these big time ones, and that's after a 7-6 season where Alabama lost to Louisiana Monroe. In Urban Meyer's first full cycle at Florida, they got Percy Harvin, Tim Tebow, Carl Johnson, Brandon Spikes, etc. There were 9 top 100 players. Urban Meyer's 2013 class at Ohio State, Jimbo Fisher doing the same thing at Florida State, Gene Chizik's first full cycle at Auburn. They brought in 3 top 100 high school recruits. That's Michael Dyer, Trevon Reed, defensive lineman Corey Lemonier.
Gary, you're just running off a bunch of names of other coaches that did better than this.
That's what I'm saying. Kirby Smart's first full cycle.
I don't give a fuck about any of these players, Gary. You're just naming off a bunch of guys. Who cares? Okay? The point has been made. The question I have is very simple. Did any of those guys lose all of their coordinators after their first season and turn that over?
No. No. Well, take that back.
Then what the fuck are we talking about?
Hold on. Nick Saban did. 2007, going into 2008.
All right, now you're comparing Harsin to Saban.
Yeah, and you can't do that.
What are we doing?
But that's what I'm saying.
Think about the names that you just rolled off.
You are having to coach against these guys.
All of these people won national championships. You're comparing them to them?
Is that not what you're striving for? Goal.
I understand it. God damn it. Yes, that's what we're all striving for, but very few people are anywhere close to that.
Agreed.
So because Harsin's not Nick Saban, god damn, what are we doing? Let's all just take him out back and shoot him in the head then. Fuck it. What are we talking about?
No, do I think that this is fair? Absolutely not. I think this is the boosters trying to get their guy in.
84 names across 9 different coaches that did better than him their first year as a head coach in a new spot. What the fuck, man?
Yeah, that's the name of the game is recruiting in the SEC. And they obviously did not do a good job with it. I understand where you're coming from as far as the coordinators go.
Apparently you don't, because you thought that was still important.
Well, here's the deal. We still don't have a situation. He brought in a defensive coordinator, which is Jeff Schmetting, who was his DC at Boise State, right?
He brought in somebody he knows and he trusts after dealing with what he dealt with his first year. There's no doubt in my mind he's going to surround himself with people he's comfortable with.
Agreed. Now, we'll see what he does with the OC.
That's what I would do, too, by the way.
Oh, yeah, especially now. I mean, you've seen how this thing works. Now you know what you got into.
Nobody in that locker room is not a me guy. Everybody in there is in the tank for me.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't care your credentials anymore. I just need to make sure that we don't have any problems. We're all going in the same direction. Even if it's the wrong direction, we're all going in that direction.
So tell me this, before we get into, you know, possible candidates, etc. Do you think that he is the head coach when they have the SEC coaches meetings at the end of the week?
I have no idea. I don't know what good it does to play this game. I don't know.
All right, so let's talk about candidates.
I'll tell you this. The answer to that is yes, because they don't have enough. They tried to do some chicanery to fire him for calls, and they don't have calls, and they're not going to pay another coach like this.
Yeah, the payout,
because they know to get the next coach, they're going to have to pay a whole lot more. So no, they're not. He's the guy. He's the guy for this year. That's the answer.
The buyout here is $18.2 million, and according to some of the money people there, that is walking around money. They would owe him half of it, I believe, or 60% of that. I think in the first 30 days, so they'd be cutting a check for like $10 million.
I understand that, but you're speaking like everybody there agrees that Harsin's out. Most of the Auburn people, this is the problem, is we have a loud-ass minority that is acting this way at Auburn, of the boosters. And the rest of them are very comfortable with giving 3 years, and let's see what he does, and let's judge him then.
Right. They are swapping over.
So while that is walking around money for a lot of these guys, Gary, most of those guys don't want to pay it. And if the athletic director doesn't want to pay it and they want to give the guy a chance, forget about wanting to pay it. They want to give the guy a chance. Then what are we talking about?
So that's the other part of this. The president, Jay Googe, is headed out. This summer, he is gone, and they have a new president that is starting in. And I forget the guy's name. It was just announced last week. New president, and it appears that if Harsin is gone, the boosters are going to get their pick on the next AD as well. They want Alan Green gone because he didn't go with the way that they wanted to with the head football coach. So everybody's kind of talked about the fact that Alan Green is looking around at other gigs, doesn't necessarily want to be there, et cetera, right? Which is interesting because he just gave Bruce Pearl this gigantic contract, but regardless, if Bryan Harsin does not survive this, if they decide, you know what, we're going to go ahead and just pay whatever this is and we will get who we want in here, let's talk about the potential candidates for this job.
I'm not interested in doing that.
I just didn't talk about the candidates.
No, because we're just throwing a bunch of names at the wall that don't matter because the job's not open.
Chris Lowe talked about this. How about this? I'll read off the names that he said. We'll see if any of them make sense. He brought up Kiffin.
I bet it's Matt Rhule. I bet it's Hugh Freeze. I bet it's all the same fucking names we threw out for every other job that we thought was going to come open, but never came open.
So Freeze was on there. Kiffin, of course, was on there. Kevin Steele is the defensive coordinator at Miami. Would this, like, I don't know if, I don't think they're worried about a splash hire or whatever. I think they just want somebody that will do what they want them to do. I think Kevin Steele makes a ton of sense. They brought up Mike Gundy. That's not happening. Jeff Grimes, the offensive coordinator at Baylor, and Bill Clark, the UAB head coach. Do you see any circumstances where Bill Clark would sell himself to go be the Auburn head football coach?
I think Bill Clark wants to coach in the SEC.
I do, too. I feel like he wants to be able to run his own program, and I don't know if you can do that at all.
Well, nobody else has called him, so.
True. That's true. We'll see. We will see what happens there. Thanks for listening to the Winning Cures Everything podcast. The website is winningcureseverything.com, and if you want to connect with us, we're on Twitter, at GaryWCE, at ChrisBGiannini, at WinningCures, or you can email us, Gary@winningcureseverything.com, or Chris@winningcureseverything.com. Subscribe everywhere you need to subscribe, and we'll see you soon.